Welcome to the summary of week 2. This week we considered the trigonometric and exponential functions and logarithms. We first looked at trigonometric functions, that is, the sine, cosine and tangent function. There are two basic ways to define the trigonometric functions: by looking at a right-angled triangle and by looking at the unit circle. In a right-angled triangle with angle theta, the sine of theta is equal to the quotient of the opposite side and the hypotenuse. In the unit circle, it is the y-coordinate of a point rotated counterclockwise over an angle theta from the positive x-axis. The cosine equals the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, or the x-coordinate in the unit circle. The tangent function is equal to the opposite side divided by the adjacent side, and thus satisfies the relation tangent of theta equals sine of theta divided by cosine of theta. Remember that the inputs of these functions are typically angles, and that in calculus we measure angles in radians. The length s of an arc of angle theta equals the radius of a circle times theta. Thus, a full circle is 2 pi radians, because that is the circumference of the unit circle. To convert degrees to radians, you can multiply by a factor of 2 pi divided by 360. You should know the values of the sine and cosine for certain special angles. These are given in the table. Using symmetries, you can extend this table to other special angles. As you learned last week, another important method to visualize functions is to look at the graph. The graph of the cosine is periodic, and you can see it is symmetric in the y-axis, so the cosine is even. The graph of the sine is also periodic and point symmetric in the origin, so the sine is odd. From the graph of the tangent, you can see that the period equals pi, and that it has vertical asymptotes at the points where the cosine vanishes. Other important formulas for the trigonometric functions are sine of x squared plus cosine of x squared equals 1, which follows from the theorem of Pythagoras. You also learned how to transform a sine into a cosine and vice versa. You also recall the addition and doubling formulas. They can be very convenient to solve equations. Then we consider compositions. A composition of two functions means you first apply one function and then another. The order in which you compose can be important, as for example, 2 to the power x squared is unequal to 2 to the power x squared. Recognizing that a function is a composition can be helpful, as then you might use a substitution to turn a complicated problem in a simpler one. Typically, it is hard to identify what the graph of a composed function looks like, but when you compose a function with the linear function, the graph changes predictably. The graph of f of x plus a is equal to the graph of f but shifted a upwards. F of x plus a shifts the graph of f a distance a to the left. A times f of x stretches the graph a factor of a in the vertical direction, while f of a times x stretches a factor of 1 over a horizontally. The compositions of a sine function with linear functions typically describe waves. Four important aspects of a wave are its amplitude, the distance between the equilibrium position and extremal values, the period, the distance between two consecutive maxima, the phase, which determines when the graph first passes through the equilibrium, and the equilibrium height, which is the average height of the function. We also considered exponential functions. Exponential functions describe many processes of growth and decay. An exponential function, a times b to the power x, has base b and exponent x. Exponentiation is repeated multiplication, and thinking about it in that way explains the important rules of calculation. Using these rules of calculation, we can also define the exponential functions for exponents x, which are rational, negative, and even arbitrary real exponents. The graph of the exponential function b to the power x is increasing if b is larger than 1, and decreasing if b is smaller than 1. Moreover, for b larger than 1, the function b to the power x grows faster than any polynomial function, which is why exponential growth is sometimes used as a synonym for very quick growth. Before we define the logarithms, which are inverses of the exponential functions, we first considered inverses in a little more detail separately. The inverse of a function f does the opposite of f, that is, f inverse y equals x precisely when y equals f of x. An inverse of a function exists only if it never gives the same output for two different inputs. And you can check this by using the horizontal line test. If this happens, we call the function injective. As inverse functions interchange the role of input and output, the domain of an inverse function is the range of the original f, and vice versa. Moreover, the graph of an inverse function is obtained by interchanging the x and y axis, that is, reflecting the graph of f in the line x equals y. The logarithm base b is the inverse function of the exponential function b to the power x. If b is unequal to 1, the exponential functions satisfy the horizontal line test, so the inverse exists. For any base, the logarithm has a vertical asymptote at x equals 0. For base b larger than 1, the graph is ever increasing. The rules of calculation for exponential functions translate to the rules for the logarithm. The last formula shows that you only need logarithms in one base to calculate all others. Typically, only a few bases are used. If the base is not explicitly mentioned, it should be clear from the context what the base is. Often this means the base is 10. Another common base is e, equals 2.718, etc. The base e has the special property that the derivative of e to the power x is e to the power x itself, which makes it very well suited for use in calculus. The logarithm with base e is called the natural logarithm and is usually written as ln. These were the main topics of this week. Good luck with your homework!